Sí, no, Cristo. Absolutely, absolutely. All right, who's going to be here with you? Okay, good. Right, right. Okay, now I'm only waiting for one thing and it's here. All right, then we can start. Right.
It's much clearer. Right.
My brothers and sisters, good morning. And I want to extend my sincerest condolences to the family of St. Clair. I am Deacon Derek Walcott. I know members of the family, and so it is truly my honor to be here. And so I ask you to please stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. In the waters of baptism, St. Clair died with Christ and rose with him to new life. May he now share with him eternal glory. What I'm going to do as part of this beautiful liturgy, this Christian liturgy, is to bless his body with holy water. What does this do? It reminds us that God has promised all of us, eternal life. A life of happiness. A life to be with him, our God and our Lord. And so the sprinkling of this holy water reminds us of that baptism which cleansed us from original sin and open the gates of paradise to each and every one of us. Let us pray. My brothers and sisters, we have come together to renew our trust in Christ, who by dying on the cross has freed us from eternal death, and by rising has opened for us the gates of paradise. Let us pray for our brother, that he will share in Christ's victory. And yes, I want us to pray for ourselves too, because we need to pray for ourselves. That the Lord will grant us the gift of his loving consolation through Christ our Lord. Amen. Would you please now be seated for the eulogy? Thank you.
Thank you. morning, all.
Good morning.
St. Clair Oswald O'Neill Sr. was born on Wednesday, May 6, 1931, to parents Iris and Alfred O'Neill. The Mytower community in San Juan is where he spent his childhood years of his life growing up with his parents. He was a resident of the area well into his 20s and his early 30s, after which he relocated to Unity Road in Dago Martin around 1961. He became well known in the Dago Martin district, where he worked as a postman, either riding his Big Ben bike or walking up the many hills and tracks to deliver meals by hand to households. St. Clair spent his entire career as a postman, working in post offices in Dago Martin, St. James, Port of Spain, and Piaco. He eventually retired in 1991, having acted as an inspector on several occasions during his final years, a position which required his overall supervision of a team of postal workers involved in the collection, sorting, distribution of all classes of mail to several regional post offices for eventual delivery. His progressive rise through the ranks of the Trinidad and Tobago Postal Service, seemed to be his reward for his dedication and serious approach he exhibited to the job and to those under his charge. It was noted that at some time during his last 5 years of employment, he turned down the opportunity to be permanently appointed to the rank of inspector. Apparently, his experiences during those acting stints convinced him that being a full-time administrator, dealing with the daily stresses of such a position, was not the way he wanted to end his career. Sinclair is the father of 9 boys and 2 girls, Glenn, Elton, Lincoln, Earl, Phyllis, Tony, Neil, Rodney, Robert, Junior, and Denise. He's the grandfather of 15 and the great-grandfather of 11. Our early memories of Daddy are that of a man who cherished the things he possessed. In fact, up to his dying day, he had a Betamax VCR, a Sylvania stereo set, as well as a shortwave radio, all of which are over 4 decades old. He had a love for music and enjoyed all genres, including classicals like James Last, the soul music of the 60s and the 70s, as well as old-time calypso, which he would listen to on his 40-year-old stereo that could play radio, records, and cassettes. Amazingly, this stereo is still in working condition. His outlook on life during his 91 years can be summed up in a few phrases which he would express when he felt that he had a point to get across. In those seldom exchanges, he would remark that, and I quote, "People make time for what is important to them, and it is what it is," reflecting a deliberate approach not to worry too much about the challenges of life. Daddy was blessed with the ability to live independently, seeing to his own needs for food, clothing, and shelter, for all except of the last 2 months of his life as a retiree. Even with a troublesome leg, he would still challenge himself to go daily to a nearby shop to purchase his newspaper around 7 o'clock every day. He would later settle into doing the Sudoku puzzle in his favorite newspaper, The Newsday, which he believed kept his cognitive abilities undiminished despite his advanced age. He kept abreast of local, regional, international, political, financial, and economic events and trends. During the last weeks of his life, he endured health challenges which required urgent surgery. He surprised the doctors and nurses with his recovery from the surgical procedure despite his age. Daddy lived a colorful 91 years on this earth. In those days, just before his death, he shared with his daughter Denise that he was going to die. It seems that he was already at peace and ready to make his final journey to the great beyond. May he rest in peace. Amen.
Would you please stand for the opening prayer? Almighty God and Father, it is our certain faith that your Son, who died on the cross, was raised from the dead, the first fruits of all who have fallen asleep. Grant that through this mystery, your servant Sinclair, who's gone to his rest in Christ, may share in the joy of his resurrection. We ask you this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Would you please be seated now for the readings?
A reading from the book of the Ephesians. You have probably heard how I have been entrusted by God with the grace he meant for you, and that it was by a revelation that I was given the knowledge of the mystery, as I have described it very shortly. If you read my word, you will have some idea of the depths that I see in the mystery of Christ. This that has now been revealed through the Spirit to his holy apostles and prophets was unknown to any men in past generations. It means that pagans now share the same inheritance, that they are parts of the same body, and that the same promise has been made to them in Jesus Christ through the gospel. I have been made the servant of that gospel by a gift of grace from God, who gave it to me by his own power. I, who am less than the least of all the saints, have been entrusted with this special grace, not only of proclaiming to the pagans the infinite treasure of Christ, but also of explaining how the mystery is to be dispensed. Through all the ages, this has been kept hidden in God, the creator of everything. Why? So that the sovereignties and powers should learn only now, through the church, how comprehensive God's wisdom really is, exactly according to the plan which he had had from all eternity in Christ Jesus our Lord. This is why we are bold enough to approach God in complete confidence through our faith in him. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
Would you please stand? Stay awake and stand ready, because you do not know the hour when the Son of Man is coming. Be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke. Jesus said to his disciples, "You may be quite sure of this, that if the householder had known at what hour the burglar would come, he would not have let anyone break through the wall of his house. You too must stand ready, because the Son of Man is coming at an hour you do not expect." Peter said, "Lord, do you mean this parable for us or for everyone?" The Lord replied, "What sort of steward then is faithful and wise enough for the master to place him over his household, to give them their allowance of food at the proper time? Happy that servant if his master's arrival finds him at this employment. I tell you truly, he will place him over everything that he owns. But as for the servant who says to himself, 'My master is taking his time coming,' and sets about beating the men servants and the maids, and eating and drinking and getting drunk, his master will come on a day he does not expect, and at an hour he does not know. The master will cut him off and send him to the same fate as the unfaithful. The servant who knows what his master wants, but has not even started to carry out those wishes, will receive many strokes of the lash. The one who did not know, but deserves to be beaten for what he has done, will receive fewer strokes. When a man has had a great deal given him, a great deal will be demanded of him. When a man has sisters, the gospel, the good news of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Please have a seat. And I want everybody to close their eyes for me, please. Please open your eyes. That, my brothers and sisters, is one of our brother's favorite songs. I only hope that all you know what that song is. Anybody could tell me what that song is? Because if you don't know that song, then you really don't know that he loved James last. And all you won't know what the name of that song is. So let me just ask a question inside here. Anybody knows what the name of that song is by James Last? Time to say goodbye. Time to say goodbye by James Last. And I chose that song, that beautiful song for St. Clair, because he loved James Last, as we heard. And Jesus is saying in this gospel, there will be a time for all of us to say goodbye. Are you ready? Are you ready? This amazing gospel that Jesus gave us for this beautiful day, you know, it's the gospel of the day. And Jesus said to his disciples, you too must stand ready because the Son of Man is coming at an hour you do not expect. So are you ready to say goodbye? Or you want some more time? What's the story? Do you need more time? And I think everybody inside here would want more time. And so we see in this man's life that, yes, he was dedicated. He was dedicated to the vocation that God called him to be. From the very beginning of his working life, he was a postman. To the very end. Dedicating his life to doing what? Yes, I would say he brought good news and bad news to people. For those who got their bills in the mail, they would say that's bad news. For those who got their pension checks in the mail, tax returns in the mail, happy birthday, anniversaries, Merry Christmas, he brought good news. Are you bringing good news? He was faithful to his vocation till the end. Many of us are not faithful to our vocations. God has given us to be stewards over our lives and the people in our lives. Are you faithful stewards, or will he come? Will he come? And you are not faithful. You are not ready. This is something that I do at funerals. So you all have a program in front of you all. Everybody take out your programs for me, please. Because we heard that he not only liked James Last, but he liked his calypsos. He played them on his 40-year-old, no, he real good. On his, all of his 40-year-old, hold on, I know it is, you know, I'm from that era. You know, they used to call it the radiograms in those age. Yeah, hearing everybody bawling, yeah. Record players, the long play and the 45s, the short play, you know, the 33s. Yes, I come from that age too. So, I want you to look at the program. Whose face you see here on the program? Whose face? Sinclair? Now, you know, whether you believe in God or not, one day your face will be on a program like this. I want you to remember what I'm saying here. Whether you believe in God or you don't believe in God, one day you go dead. My question and God's question in this beautiful gospel, in St. Clair's life, he's saying, are you prepared? Are you prepared? Or you're like a Zandoli? Are you prepared? That you're not staying true to the vocation and the call that God called you to be. He loved music. He cherished what he possessed. He cherished, you hear the words, by his son, he cherished what he possessed. That's being a good steward of what God has given to you. Because even after 40 years, if it could be still working, it means to say that you were a good steward of what God has given to you. And even though he had challenges in his life, you know, he always said what we heard from his son, that people make time to what is important to them. Are you making time to what is important to you? Well, I want to let you know that one of the things that Almighty God wants you to spend time in doing, because it should be very important for all of us, is to spend time with God first and to spend time with family. Spend time with family. Family, my brothers and sisters, is the bedrock, is the foundation of our society. And what we are seeing right now is a total destruction of our society. We are on a path to break all the records of murders for any year in this little 2x4 country, as they like to say on 95.5. In this 2x4 country, every day we're reading about man's inhumanity to man. Every day you pick up his favorite newspaper, the Newsday, you will read it. And God is saying to all of us, I want you to spend time with what is important. I want you to spend time in knowing God's word, that he is going to come again. And will you be a good steward of your wives, your husbands, your children, your jobs, those you employ, and those who employ you? We see that in his life, he rose from the rank of being a postman, yes, to be someone who inspected the good news that went out throughout Trinidad and Tobago, supervising people under his care to ensure that they also were faithful to their vocation. All the people who needed to get the mail when they needed to get it, he was there to make sure that, yes, you got it. And all those under his care, are you good stewards as Sinclair was a good steward? Today, I ask you all, this is a message that God wants for all of us. Are you good stewards? Happy the servant if his master's arrival finds him at this employment. So stay awake, as the beautiful gospel acclamation says, stay awake and stand ready, because you do not know the hour the Son of Man is coming. And in that beautiful first reading with St. Paul to the Ephesians, you've probably heard how I have been entrusted by God with the grace he meant for you. And that is and was by a revelation that I was given the knowledge of the mystery. As I have just described it very shortly, if you read my word, you will have some idea of the depths that I see in the mystery of Christ. Holy Scripture is important for all of us. Lack of knowledge of Scripture is the lack of knowledge of God. So instead of all your just every morning taking up all your phone, the first thing before all you even say, thank God I alive, and you're checking your WhatsApp message, pick up a little bit of Scripture and read what the Lord is saying to you today. What is God saying to me in Holy Scripture? Ignorance of Scripture is ignorance of God. So when you wake up in the morning, Don't check your WhatsApp message or your Instagram or your TikTok. Right? Read the word of God. Thank him for another day of life. And before you go to bed, turn off the damn phone. Give God thanks. Because you know in the middle of the night, you're only hearing billing, bing. And you're only waking up in the midst of a good sleep to check who sent you some stupid TikTok. But God is saying, TikTok, TikTok, your time is running out. Are you ready? Are you ready? He is coming at an hour you do not know. Amen. Would you please stand? God the Almighty Father raised Christ his Son from the dead. With confidence we ask him to save all his people living and dead. For Sinclair, who in baptism was given the pledge of eternal life, that he may now be admitted to the company of the saints. Lord, hear us. For our brother who knew his vocation to be a good steward, we pray, Almighty God, that all of us learn from his example of being a good steward, being dedicated to the job that God has called us to. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
For our deceased relatives and friends, and for all who have helped us, that they may have the reward of their goodness. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We pray now for all those who've fallen asleep, those who've died, like Sinclair, in the hope of rising again, that they may see God face to face. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
And for my brother, yes, my brother who had all these children, yes, I heard he had, like me, nine boys and two girls, grandchildren of 15, great-grandchildren, I wasn't too sure of the number because I was kind of frightened to make the wrong call. 11? 12, you see that? I make the wrong call. A dozen. 11, you see, I was right. Oh God, I miss. You lose count. We give thanks, Lord, and we ask that those who mourn him, that they may be comforted. They may be comforted and consoled in their grief by the Lord who wept at the death of his friend Lazarus. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
A man is given 70 if he's good. 10 more years if he's really good. And if he get more than that, he has been blessed. St. Clair was truly blessed. We pray, Almighty God, that he will be welcomed into paradise. He was not a perfect man, none of us are. But God is a God of love and mercy. And so we pray that Almighty God in his love and mercy will raise him up on the last day. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Almighty God, you are our shelter and our strength. You listen in love to the cry of your people. Hear the prayers that we offer for our departed brother. Cleanse him of his sins and grant him the fullness of redemption. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And while we are standing, we will now pray the family prayer. Regardless of the faith or religion that you belong to, you can pray this prayer. It is the Our Father. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. The peace of the Lord be with you always. My brothers and sisters, for thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. And he wants us now to share with one another a sign of peace. Now hold on. Hold on. COVID's still going around. It's still killing people. If you are living in the same house with the person next to you, just give them a box. If you're living in the house with the person next to you, you could hug them up. Share with one another now a sign of peace. And now, my brothers and sisters, I invite you to sit as we enter the final commendation. And before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of our brother. And may our farewell express our affection for him. May it ease any sadness that we feel and strengthen our hope that one day we will see our brother St. Clair again and joyfully greet him. We will dance to the music he loved together. We will enjoy everlasting life. And we will greet him when the love of Christ, which conquers all things, will conquer death itself. And so I'm going to go once more to the coffin and sprinkle it. I'm going to sprinkle holy water, reminding us of, yes, our baptisms, God's promise to all of us of eternal life, if we just listen to his word. St. Clair, your servant. In the sight of this world, he is now dead, but in your sight, he will live forever. Forgive whatever sins he committed through human weakness, and in your goodness, grant him everlasting peace. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Almighty God, because you have chosen to call our brother from this life to yourself, we commit his body to the earth, to its final resting place. For we are dust, and unto dust we shall return.
Spirit.
Almighty God, we know that you will change his mortal body to be like yours, Jesus. Because you've risen the firstborn from the dead. And so, yes, we've commended our brother to the Lord, that you will embrace him in peace and raise him up on the last day. I invite you to stand, my brothers and sisters, and let us all as community, friends and family of St. Clair, bow our heads and ask for God's blessing. Merciful Lord, you know the anguish of the sorrowful and you're attentive to the prayers of the humble. Hear your people who cry out to you in their need and strengthen their hope in your lasting goodness. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Eternal rest grant unto him, O Lord. Eternal rest grant unto him, O Lord. And may his soul and the souls of all the faithful departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace. Amen. And may the peace of God, which is beyond all understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. And may Almighty God bless you all in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
St. Clair, may the angels lead you into paradise. May the martyrs come to welcome you and lead you to the holy city, the new and eternal Jerusalem. May the choirs of angels welcome you and lead you to the bosom of Abraham. And where Lazarus, my brother, is poor no longer, may you find eternal rest. My brothers and sisters, go in the peace of the Lord. Thanks be to God. God bless you all. God bless you all. And you have my love and my prayers. I just want to share one last thing before I go. That every November, as my beloved know, right, I have a table at St. Anthony's and at Nativity. And I place the programs of all the funerals that I've done, of all the people that I've celebrated their passing. And I place it and I pray for them every single day in the month of November. St. Clair's program will also be on that table of repose at St. Anthony's. May God bless you and keep you safe. Amen.
Amen.
What are we singing?
I'm walking on my way.
Song is good.